Thank you for tuning in. I'm Eric Skye.
And I'm Ben Wade.
The following podcast was created by Colorado Water Conservation Board staff as a special two-part release highlighting the Platte River Recovery Implementation Program. We'd love to continue making more of these, so please let us know what topics you'd like to hear us cover in the future. Please send all feedback and suggestions as a direct message to our Twitter handle at @DNR_CWCB. With us today, we have CWCB's Endangered Species Specialist, JoJo Law.
JoJo, if you could quickly just introduce yourself and just let us know what we're going to be hearing today on our podcast.
Yeah, thank you for having me on the show today. My name is JoJo, and I'm the CWCB's Endangered Species Policy Specialist, and I'm really excited for the program today, and we're entitling this program Three Birds and One Fish, and that's really the reason for the program, but I'm excited to introduce some of our panelists that we'll be listening to, and they'll tell you more about the history of the program and why we're here, and those three birds and one fish. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about these species. Do you guys know much about these three birds and one fish?
I just know about the whooping crane.
Yeah, those hoopers are out there hooping around.
Whooping crane.
Yep, that's probably the more correct pronunciation of that bird.
Is it though? I'm kidding. For anyone who pronounces it hoopers, you're totally fine.
So that's probably the most famous bird that makes this program famous. It is an endangered species, and it's the only self-sustaining population left in the world, and it makes a migratory stop in the Platte area, Central Platte area. You know, we've come a long way from 1941, when there was about 16 individuals counted back then, and this year we've seen a record number of cranes, about 120 that actually migrate. So the numbers are increasing, and it's something that most folks can relate with. However, there's two other birds that we know about there that they also share the fame with the whooping crane. So we also have the least tern and the piping plover. Plovers are also listed as endangered, and the success of the program is really tremendous because in the recent five-year review, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service actually recommending delisting the tern. So not even downgrading, but just delisting completely from the endangered species list. So we're seeing tremendous success in these programs, and we hope to think that it's part of the recovery program, the reason why. And finally, we have a fish, and most people don't know about the fish. And you'll hear in some of these clips that this fish will really be the focus of the recovery program going in the future. We've focused a lot of our energy in creating bird habitat, understanding and researching birds, but this fish is even more difficult to find, and it's something that I'll probably spend the rest of my career looking at, is this fish. So with that, I'd like to introduce the start of our panelists here. So on today's show, you'll hear from Alan Berryman and Deb Freeman from Northern Water, Don Ament, our State of Colorado Recovery Program Representative, and Kevin Urie from Denver Water.
Awesome. So yeah, we've got a collection of clips for everyone today from a workshop we actually held back in June of 2018, where we had those folks come and kind of share their experiences with how the program developed, where it's at now, and some of their thoughts for the future. So this first clip is going to be from Alan Berryman, and he's going to be describing how some of these consultations with the feds actually raised a number of difficult issues.
In the early 90s, 1991, 92, 93, there was those six entities or five that needed permits from Forest Service. They were projects already built, and they had to re-up their permits, and they did the consultation with the Fish and Wildlife Service, and the Fish and Wildlife Service says, well, you're going to have to deal with these endangered species. And the way they wanted to do that was they said, look, if you're going to do this, you're going to have to replace your depletions to the species on a one-for-one basis. And two, you're going to have to give us some money because we want to buy habitat land to help protect the habitat for the species in Nebraska. Yeah, it was kind of a one-on-one. Everybody was doing their own consultation. I mean, we had a lot of meetings. I was with the state at the time, and I remember going to those. And we went back and forth with the feds for quite a while. I know I got involved. I was a division engineer. And one of the things was, oh, are you going to deliver water to Nebraska? Well, that brought up all kinds of issues like compact issues, export statutes, those kind of things. Anyway, we went around and around for I don't know, 3 years or so, and all these issues came alive. These six entities needed about, they would have to replace about 9,500 acre feet of water a year, which is a pretty big chunk for that many consultations. Well, we knew that we had several hundred more coming up in the future, And basically what we began to realize as water users, there's probably not enough water in the whole Platte Basin to do one-for-one replacement of existing water uses. And we knew it was just a non-starter for us to get there. It also started raising the issues about export statute and compact. Would we deliver water from somewhere upstream in Colorado past water users? Because, if you're going to do an export statute that says you're not supposed to affect existing water users in Colorado, it also kind of brings up, does it impact your compact? Because you're getting into kind of a commerce clause business, where you might lose the protections under the compact. We have several people telling us be extremely careful on that matter.
Okay, so we got to deliver water to Nebraska. We've got potential for a statutory violation. This honestly sounds like a huge storm for litigation and lawsuits. JoJo, how did they get around that?
Yeah, so as Alan explained, Colorado was really grappling with this huge issue. And it not only rose interstate compact issues, but it also had this perception that, yes, we're only sending water down to Nebraska. And as a headwater state, that brings up a lot of issues in how we in Colorado develop water, and in addition, how we mitigate those depletions and protect endangered species at the same time. And so I do want to make it very clear that we are in compliance with our 1923 interstate compact, and we are not at risk of violation. So that is really the reason why it took 12 long years to negotiate a program, because how do you negotiate a cooperative agreement that protects all of these interests at the same time, both a water development interest, both a environmental conservation interest, and protecting interstate compact laws? So, our forefathers that came before us, who are going to speak in this panel, really were very strategic and brilliant on how they structured this program. And it all started with a depletion plan, both a historic and a future depletion plan, and a little project that we like to call the Tamarack Plan, which you'll hear a little bit more.
And just to quickly define what a depletion plan is, basically it's Colorado's commitment on how we will mitigate new water-related activities in the basin. This includes depletions pre-1997 and future depletions.
And what really sparked these issues were, as Alan explained, the complications of ESA compliance, and what really led to what had to be a collaborative effort between three states. So we'll hear a little bit more about what Deb has to say about how this collaborative program started.
The service was very strategic on these biological opinions that were coming out in the early 1900s, 1990s, excuse me. So we talked about the Front Range facility owners in Colorado. There in the draft biological opinion that came out, the service did you have jeopardy one-for-one replacement of depletions, amount, and timing at the state line, or you can throw your hat in a yet-to-be-finalized or developed recovery program. So they kind of gave that impetus. They did the same thing elsewhere in the basin. So Kingsley was going through FERC relicensing, Lake McConaughey. And there, and they had been operating under annual licenses and all, and they got sued on that, and they entered into full-blown FERC relicensing, and it was a wild time. There were oodles of interveners in that process, and they were getting hung up under Section 7 of the ESA. The service also requested initiation of consultation on all the big reclamation projects. So the North Platte projects, the East Slope CBT facilities, those had entered consultation. The Coors Tri-Lake system had entered consultation. And we in Colorado had we had concerns, obviously, with this was the first time on the South Platte where we had concerns that the species were not even in our state. And should we try to self-mitigate up within the boundaries of our own state, or should we join a program, a three-state program, and try to surround some of the problems that really we felt were the more causal problems to the species.
So how did this new consultation process really affect the Platte Basin?
So basically, any proposed water project constructed in the South Platte Basin that has a federal nexus and a depletion effect requires an environmental permit. So basically, that's all water diversion projects in the South Platte. And with those environmental permits, typically the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service considers those depletions a jeopardy to endangered species or a threat to the endangered species in Nebraska. And they must mitigate or replace those project depletions. So pursuant to the Endangered Species Act of 1973, formal Section 7 consultations are required. And what is especially notable about this program for Colorado is that Colorado gains the most benefit. And what I mean by that is that out of the 188 total streamlined Section 7 consultations conducted since the start of the program, 147 of these have occurred in Colorado.
So, you know, what Deb describes is probably one of the most important things that changed the way that projects in the South Platte Basin are permitted in the state. And, you know, I think if you talk to most water developers or users now who are new to the game, you know, it really does change how folks permit projects. And nowadays, I think that it's a little bit forgotten that what our leaders before us had to go through to actually permit projects. But what folks don't know is that this program really made it easier for folks to have a more streamlined consultation, which just means that water users can now use our existing biological opinions for these species, pay a little bit of money, and get their permit. And this program covers their depletions, covers their permitting, and makes the process a little bit more easy. And so hopefully these little clips kind of shed light on how we got there. And you know, it took a little bit of negotiating. And our representative, Donna Ment, describes exactly how that process went and how everyone just came together in the end.
In 1998, I was chairman of the Senate Ag Committee in Colorado. And you can imagine we were starting to talk a lot about Endangered Species Act and what the implications of all that were. And of course, people like Deb Freeman are whispering in your ear, you know, you got a Jeopardy opinion going to show up out there, and you got four endangered species out there on the Platte, and we're going to have to do something about that. And so this, in part, started an incredible team of people working together, which you've heard some of right away. Primarily, I have to tell you, the partnership that became very evident soon was you had Northern Water, you had Denver Water, you soon had SPRAP, you had the Water Conservation Board, which is sponsoring us primarily today with Denver Water. Water Conservation Board was staffing a lot of the activities and being a major part of that. You had the Parks and Wildlife involved. You had just numerous players all of a sudden coming forward to help with this. And there were several things we had to accomplish. First of all, we had a three-year program that amounted into a 10-year program of a cooperative agreement, figuring out how we were all going to play in the sandbox together. That was tremendously difficult, and even to this day, we have a little skirmishes about how we play together. And so to put that all together was pretty tremendous. And then to pass legislation that would fund all of this was another big issue, which I want you to all start thinking about today, because this program has been so successful. Yesterday when I'm talking to legislators of the water interim, I was surprised at how many people just take this all for granted. They aren't even aware of a recovery program out of the Platte because it doesn't even impact them. So here we are, we put together this program, and very fortunate in Colorado at that time, the budget situation was pretty plush, really. And it wasn't all that difficult for Colorado to, in three consecutive, as I believe they were consecutive, but there were three budget years that we passed $8 million to fund this program from Colorado's obligation. And I don't know, I don't think looking around this room, nobody really doesn't understand the fact that this is a partnership between Wyoming, Nebraska, and Colorado with the federal government. And the federal government picks up 50% of it, and Colorado and Nebraska and Wyoming pick up the other 50%. So that's how financially we take a look at this. At that time, it wasn't much of a problem really for the feds to come up with their share of the budget. So when we really started out in this program,
dollars were not a particular problem. It was how to manage those dollars, how to acquire 10,000 acres of habitat, how to acquire 130 to 150,000 acre feet of water, and then manage all of that in such a way under an adaptive management program that would say, if this isn't working, we're going to try something else. And so we had an ISE group, Independent Science Advisory Group, that looked at all of it, lots of monitoring that went on so that our adaptive management program was effective. So all of this really came together and was extremely effective.
I can't imagine having that many different entities in one room trying to negotiate something like this, especially when we're coming to the table, as Plush, as Don would say. So how did that work moving forward with trying to make sure everyone has a fair share in this game?
And you know, I'm having this brilliant picture in my head where Donna Met and Deb Freeman and Alan are all in this sandbox together and, you know, duking it out with the other states.
I was picturing us as Mr. Moneybags from Monopoly, to be honest with you.
And as
do not pass go. Do not collect 200 hoopers.
And as funny as that is, you know, really what Don was getting down to is that it wasn't a matter of funds, which typically the conversation is about, is how much money can we bring to the table. But imagine getting all these entities and all these interests together. And, you know, one key point of this program, unlike other recovery programs, is that the goal of the program is not measured by how many birds or how many fish we recover, but rather by specific milestones. So all of these entities in the three states and the Department of Interior had to get together and decide what our milestones were. And that was really strategic as well. It was decided that instead of the number of birds and fish that we recover, that was not really practical because these birds are migratory. What happens if all the birds, you know, there was a massive disease and all of a sudden, or they just decided that they wanted to winter in Florida instead of the Central Platte, you know? So
that's where I would go for the winter.
That's the best golf.
If I could fly, yeah, exactly. Get my Hawaiian shirt on, go hoop around.
Whoop, there it is.
So the key negotiating points was how much land are we going to commit to providing as a program, as three states, how much water, and through what mechanism. And so what the three states and partners agreed to is that in the first 13 years of the program between 2007 and 2019 is that we as an entire program would provide and protect up to 10,000 acres of habitat. For the water component, we provide 130,000 to 150,000 acre feet per year of water, and we would do this all through adaptive management. Now, it's really important to note that the 130,000 to 150,000 acre feet of water milestone is a negotiated amount, so that's what the partners agreed to and thought that they could achieve in the first 13 years. And those numbers are actually based off of target flows that the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service thought that that's what the species needed. And throughout this next clip, you'll actually hear Kevin refer to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service as just the service. And in 1994, the service determined that there was an average of 417,000 acre feet per year shortage of water at the Grand Island Gauge in Nebraska, and that was a shortage to their in-stream recommended flows.
You guys have heard us talk about the 417,000 acre feet of water that the service was deeming necessary in order to give non-jeopardy opinions for water projects. And how that came about was the service, through some hooping crane modeling and some other habitat evaluations, designed what are called target flows. And these are flows that they designed that were needed in their belief through the Central Platte to maintain or create habitat that's important for tern and plover nesting and reproduction, as well as hooping crane migratory habitat. So the service identified target flows that were needed for different bird species for some of the forage fish were in all these target flows. They broke it up into different segments throughout the year, and based on those, they determined how much water was needed through the Central Platte. Again, most of the every one of those target flows has a forage fish component or a fish component in it. A lot of them have other species needs besides the target species, bald eagles, sandhill cranes. As you can imagine, there's maybe some overlap of sandhill crane and hooping crane needs. I get that. But anyway, when you take those, they identify target flows for dry periods, for normal or average periods, and for wet periods. And tried to reflect those. So if you take those on an average bases across all those year types, that's how they developed the 417,000 acre feet of shortage that they believe was needed and required by the program. So as you've heard, we were able to negotiate because we recognized getting 417 was just not even a reasonable ask and probably not even possible. So part of the negotiation was this 130,000 to 150,000 acre foot of what we call shortages to target flows, and that's what it basically means. We're gonna take 130 to 150,000 off that 417. Let's put it in the system and let's see how we can use that to improve the species conditions and habitats. And so again, the 417 is basically those target flows on an average annual across all water years. The 130 to 150 was the negotiated term that we negotiated in development of the program. We recognized that we couldn't get the 417. Not only that, we really believed that wasn't likely what was needed.
Jojo, you referenced the Tamarack plan earlier. Could you please bring us all up to speed on what that is for the folks like me who have no idea what you're talking about?
Sure, Ben. So the Tamarack plan is what Colorado brought to the table as its water contribution at the start of this program. Each state brought their own project, and that was to make progress towards the 130,000 to 150,000 acre feet of water milestone in the first 13 years. So in total, all three states brought about 80,000 acre feet of water to the program, and Tamarack was our contribution. And so for Colorado, this was one of the hardest issues to address at the initiation of the program. It was a huge dilemma, and the dilemma was that state law requires that water must be used for a beneficial use. So the question in Colorado was, how do we, as a program, require water to flow past state lines without a decreed use? And it was actually quite brilliant how our leaders came up with the water. The Tamarack plan, in so many words, is basically a bunch of wells and recharge ponds that retime about 10,000 acre feet of water. So basically, how it works is we divert water from the South Platte River during times of excess. This mainly happens in December and January. And this is when the species don't need as much of the water. And it slowly trickles back to the South Platte. And it trickles back in times of need, so in February and through June. So not only does this provide the beneficial use, and that being wildlife, but during that time, the water users of the lower basin needed to replace their well depletions as well. And this concept of retiming water became a very collaborative effort.
So we had that period just before 1994 with the facility owners that just weren't getting anywhere. We had quite a discussion. We had a lot of people tell us, well, just go change the endangered species law. And I can't tell you how many people told us that. And then there were several that said, well, let's litigate. We'll win. And we didn't find one attorney that told us we could win in all that time that I remember. There were several examples, and probably the biggest one was the Central Nebraska Public Power and Irrigation District had been negotiating with the feds for 10 years or so. They'd spent about $12 million and still hadn't gotten anywhere. So after a bunch of that discussion, we thought, well, you know what? We'll get into this. We'll try this basin-wide program in 94. So we dove right in, but we knew we had some limitations on how we wanted to do things. One, you know, with the export statute, our advice was that was given to us, let's see if we can find a way not to deliver water into Nebraska. Let's not build reservoirs to start, you know, where we might bump up against the Commerce Clause. So we thought, you know what, if we're going to do water, number one, it's hard to do too much water in Colorado. So we you know, when we got into the negotiations, we ended up giving 10,000 acre feet, which we called the Tamarack One project, of retimed water to offset all of our existing depletions up till 1997. That's what we reached when we got into the cooperative agreement in 97. We'd find 10,000 acre feet of water, but we could give more money. So that's the 24 million. So Colorado was kind of less water, more money. Nebraska was all land and water from, they gave Cottonwood Ranch. Can't remember how many acres were there, 600 and some. Maybe it's bigger than that. And then they were given the water out of Lake McConaughey, a 100,000 acre foot pool for sure, and up to 200,000 acre feet. So they were doing more water. I think they were stored out, John, what, 40 some thousand acre feet, 50,000. And then Nebraska or Wyoming gave a little bit of money. They were 6 million and some water from Pathfinder. And I think that scored out at about 26,000. Yeah. So that's kind of the pieces we put together to say, hey, look, we've got a good start towards water, and the total score of the three state projects was 80,000 acre feet. But for Colorado, again, we thought we can do groundwater recharge and and come up with the amount of water that we needed. So that's where we got started on the Tamarack plan. We started working together on, okay, we got a bunch of work to do here, finding out how we're going to do this. We got money from the CWCB to help do some of these things. We put together the first plan. We put in three wells and three little ponds, and we're going to pump that water, retime it. That got us started on, we're going to do managed groundwater recharge to come up with our water thing. And so to do that, we needed a way to do it. And that's how South Platte Lower River Group got started.
Well, that sounds like a good way to address that statutory issue of beneficial use, is by delivering groundwater via a recharge pond.
You also told us a little bit earlier about a land milestone. So why don't you give us a little brief intro to that as well?
And so, as you said, Eric, the land part of the program was a lot easier to crack because, you know, the land has to be in Nebraska, for one. And there were many entities out there, environmental entities, that already had land out there. So it was a matter of a waiting game in a real estate game on how do we get habitat near the river and purchase it and maintain it and conserve it. So we'll hear a little bit more from Kevin on this land milestone.
The milestone in the program was 10,000 acres of land and habitat that is either leased, held in fee title, and managed for the species down there. Some of the little finer detail in that, we have 10 bridge segments within the Big Bend Reach, which is Lexington to Chapman, Nebraska. It's about a 90-mile reach. There's a bridge segment, meaning a highway bridge, that crosses the river about every 10 miles. And so the concept in the land acquisition from a habitat management perspective was we would try to go out and acquire lands, and meaning we would try to get on-channel habitat for crane and turnip plover nesting, and we would acquire land around managed habitat for buffer areas, for disturbances, that kind of thing. But the idea was that we would go and try to develop a habitat complex through that land acquisition in L10 bridge segments. And that's the general premise of the idea there. There's a couple of other issues in there. As we talked earlier, there were NGOs that were managing lands down in the Central Platte. And the idea was that we would try to separate our habitat lands and try to make them somewhat congruent with some of these other conservation lands that were already on the landscape to provide increased benefit. And so the 10,000 acres of acquisition was the milestone that we agreed to, and there was additional agreement that in a future future increment of the program, the goal was actually 29,000 acres. But the idea was the program would commit to the 10,000, that first increment, with the idea that other conservation lands that were already on the landscape were actually in the tune of about 19,000 acres already being managed. And so there was discussion about, in the circumstance we negotiate a second increment, that we could potentially bring those conservation lands and get credit for those under the program to basically meet that 29,000.
Well, now we're moving into kind of like the third aspect of the Platte River Recovery Program. And this is a word that's kind of thrown around in a lot of different programs, and it means something different to every single program: adaptive management. So, Jojo, what exactly does this adaptive management mean for the program?
Yeah, and you know, the adaptive management is basically a way to say, how do we hypothesize about the solutions that may help recover the endangered species? Then we then conduct research, we implement the design solutions, we monitor, and then we just learn from what we just implemented and monitored. So it's a way to learn from these different research aspects of the program. And the Adaptive Management Program is actually one of the most successful programs in the nation. It's the only program in the entire U.S. to complete one full cycle of adaptive management. So not only have we implemented our research, but we've actually learned from what we've implemented. And this has caused some tremendous success in the program. And one example is that initially we thought, or you know, it was hypothesized that the only locations that these birds would nest are in channel.
So the program spent much of the first 13 years creating in-channel habitat, so these sandbars where these birds can nest. And with the natural way that the Platte moves, you know, we would go in and build sandbars, and then, you know, no sooner or later, those sandbars would get washed away because that's how the river moves. And so we were seeing tremendous, actually, non-success in establishing habitat on river. And so we started doing adaptive management. And one of the questions and hypotheses was, well, what if we establish off-channel habitats? So why don't we create a habitat just nearby in these gravel pits, and we create little sand beaches for them to nest on? Would that be sufficient to help in these bird recoveries? And the answer was yes. It's tremendously successful. We've seen a number of bird species nest in these sites. And so now, instead of wasting money and time trying to create these in-channel habitats that we can't ever, you know, maintain for a long amount of time, we now are looking to buy more sand pits. So it's been a tremendous success. And so Kevin will continue to explain what else is adaptive management.
Adaptive management plan under the program. And I think that when you really need to tune people into that a little bit, because not only from Colorado's perspective was that science component really important, but I think to further the discussions and our program into the future, we have to recognize the value of adaptive management. And I wanted to just maybe make quick reference to the IMRP, which is the Integrated Monitoring and Research Program. And what that did back when we started this program is there was a bunch of us technical geeks that sat in a room for who only knows how long, but started having discussions about some of the what was then defined as the competing hypotheses. And as I alluded to before, the service, Fish and Wildlife Service, believed very much that the system should be managed with water and creating it. Habitats through water and natural management systems, whereas most of the rest of us believed that, no, we can do exactly what Don said. We can use diesel fuel and big yellow equipment in the river, and we can make habitat, and maybe we can use a little bit of that water to manage. And so the IMRP really focused on a bunch of competing hypotheses that we put together as technical people across all the parties and stakeholders in the program. We developed over 300 hypotheses. Some of those looked at managing the river with flows. Some of the competing hypotheses looked at using diesel fuel and equipment. And so we had two different. There was FSM, which is the flow sediment mechanical, which is kind of the more natural system. And then we had the MCM, which was mechanical, create, and manage. And that was kind of the diesel fuel caterpillar option. And so we developed well over 300 hypotheses to test through this program. As you can imagine, to take 300 hypotheses, try to put projects on the ground and try to test for those, just there's not enough money in the world to do that. So what we had to do is we had to prioritize a bunch of those. And what came out of that exercise is really the adaptive part of the adaptive management plan. But we came down to really 11 solid hypotheses that we agreed during the first increment we would put on the ground to try to test some of these hypotheses about not only habitat creation, but what kind of habitat's needed, and then put some of that on the ground and see what the birds do. How do they respond to it? One other piece that I think is important is there's also a belief, the service believed that on-channel habitat for terns and plovers was critical. All of us believed that we could do off-channel habitat, and what I mean by that is taking existing gravel pits, managing the vegetation on those for bare sand, which is desirable by the terns and plovers, and create habitats that we could manage more meaningfully and not get into these storm flows in the summer that were inevitably wiping out their nests on the river. And so that was some of the competing hypotheses. We designed, you know, projects for on-channel habitat. We designed projects for off-channel habitat. And at the end of the day, you know, that adaptive management process and approach lets us kind of test the science, let the species tell us what they're using, what they need, and it allows us to make some decisions when there's a lot of uncertainty around all of it.
So there's your secret right there, folks. Take the Spinal Tap approach. When you only have 10 hypotheses, turn it up to 11. But now we come back to this question that we've had before is, we have these three things. Who is paying for it? How are they paying for it? How did that come to be?
And this idea of fair share was something that the states talked about a lot, and it's something that Colorado, you know, Don kind of jokingly says, you know, we were plush during that time, but it was more of a matter of Colorado, as it always, you know, because water is so hard to come by, would rather pay for the program milestones in cash than we would with wet water, because we know that wet water is a lot more expensive than just paying cash contributions. So Alan Berryman will actually talk a little bit more about what was considered fair share and how the state's contributions were decided.
Sharing is caring.
Fair share was quite a discussion for a while. It was hard, you know, everybody thought it was somebody else's problem and they were the cause of it among the states. We ended up actually, somebody made a proposal that must have struck us just about right, and that's how we came up with among the states 40-40-20 for our half. Wyoming was 20%, Colorado 40, Nebraska 40, and that was of the 50% towards the total amount. We went back and forth on a lot of different things on whose fault it was, and what does it take, and I don't know, I suppose it took several months. I remember some meetings up in Cheyenne, but fair share was finally, we just arrived at some numbers that everybody felt they could live with, I think. Everybody looked at that and said, can we do it at that level? And I think we all thought that was something that we could do. In Colorado, you know, we thought, well, water's really difficult to get, so that's why we went more with some water and more money, because we thought, at the time, we could get more money. And the other is, we're so far upstream, it's hard to make a big impact farther and farther downstream. Wyoming or Nebraska was sitting right in the middle of things, so that, you know, they did more water, and then they had the Cottonwood Ranch that was right there, the Auburn Habitat, kind of an in-kind contribution that counted towards the state's contribution towards the whole thing. Wyoming really needed Pathfinder to go forward and wanted to go forward, so they basically gave up a little over half of that or so to make theirs go, and then they had $6 million. To round out their part. The whole fair share thing was quite a discussion, but there was no great science on saying, oh, there was this many depletions here and that many depletions there and blah, blah, blah. It was finally, what could we all live with and move forward with and make the program work? I think just having this get-together has been helpful to kind of lay some of the issues that are there. I think the program in general has been very successful. It's definitely more successful than when we were back arguing about one-for-one replacements on individual consultations, I can tell you that. A long way from there, because that was a total stalemate and it was an undoable end if you looked at the big scale. So I think what we've done over time has shown how important this program is. We have a lot of people relying on it. I think what we need to concentrate on is, what does it take to keep this moving forward, to be viable, reasonable, prudent alternative to keep people using water.
So before we go, JoJo, why don't you just do a quick little recap of what all we heard today, because my head's swimming.
So as Alan said, now after 13 years, this is one of the most successful recovery programs in the nation and in Colorado. And it's working. We've met our water, or we've almost met our water milestone. We have met our land milestone, and we have a successful adaptive management program. And it's come a long way since we did one-on-one depletion mitigation. So that's all.
Yeah, that's a good place to stop for this episode. We hope everybody stays tuned for the next episode, where we learn about just the present state of this program and then what the future holds for this program. We do want to make sure that we give a huge shout out to Annette Hine, who has been working on this project. She's been editing the audio that you guys have been hearing. So again, tune in next time.
Take care, folks. Thanks for listening in.
Before we let you go, we wanted to give you a quick update. The Platte River Recovery Implementation Program was recently extended for another 13 years. In December of 2019, the program was congressionally reauthorized until the year 2032, and a cooperative agreement was signed by Governor Polis. Stay tuned for part two of this special release covering the current status and future of the program. Follow CWCB on Twitter at CWCB_DNR and Instagram at CO Water Conservation Board for updates on the next podcast, as well as to stay informed on water updates across the state.
Do, 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 do.